In the last video, we talked about linear regression, that is finding a best line through a bunch of data. And that's good for models where you have an output variable depending on one input variable. But what do you do if you've got an output variable that depends on two or more input variables? How can you model that, and how can you use linear algebra to find the best fit? So we'll take a political example. It turns out that at least as of 2013, white voters tend to vote Republican, while minority voters tend to vote Democratic. And regular churchgoers tend to vote Republican much higher than secular voters. So you might try to model how a particular county is going to vote by looking at what fraction of the voters are white and what fraction of the voters are churchgoers. And you might try to put up a model that says, that says that the percentage of the vote that the Republicans get in an election should be some constant plus another constant times the percentage of the population that's white plus another constant times the percentage of the population that regularly attends church, where we've just called X, Y, and Z, just the fraction white, fraction church-going, fraction that vote Republican. Now, that's a reasonable model, and political scientists have been making lots of money by trying to fit the data to that. And what we're really saying is we want Z to be A plus BX plus CY. So if you collect the data for, several thousand counties that are lurking in this country, you're going to get data, and each data is going to be a triple of points, X1, X2, Y1, Z1, X2, Y2, and Z2. We're saying that each Z should be A plus B times that X plus C times that Y. So we're really solving a bunch of n equations in three unknowns, where the three unknowns are the constant term, the coefficient of X, and the coefficient of Y. Well, that's exactly least squares problem, because of course we can't get it exactly equal. We just want to pick A, B, C so that the left-hand side gets as close as possible to the right-hand side. So this is our matrix A, and this is our output matrix. And before we solved AX equals B, here we have A times our coefficients equals Z. And then we go ahead and we compute A transpose A times ABC should be equal to A transpose Z. If we can solve those equations, we'll get a least squared solution to these equations. And how do you do that? Well, you multiply things out. And what you get for A transpose A is a matrix where the terms are either the number of entries, the sums of the x's, the sums of the y's, the sums of the x squareds, the sums of the x times y's, or the sum of the y squareds. And A transpose Z is the sum of the z's, the sum of the xz's, the sum of the yz's. Okay. Now, when we did linear regression, we wound up with a 2x2 matrix, and we used the formula for the inverse of a 2x2 matrix. There is a formula for the inverse of a 3x3 matrix, but it's really, really ugly. Whenever dealing with problems that are 3x3 or bigger, it's almost always better to just take your 3x3 system and row reduce it and not to try to look for a formula. Okay, that's it for multiple regression. We could also have done something with 3 or 4 or 5 inputs, and then you would have more, A would be bigger. But the procedure is the same. No matter how many inputs there are, you can find the best fit using this game. Now let's go back to the problem of having one input and one output. And suppose you have the data being these black dots. Now the best line through those black dots is something like this red line. And it ain't very good. This, if you gave me this data and said find the best line, I'd say, why line? It doesn't look like a line at all. It looks like a parabola. So instead, we should find the best parabola that fits the data. And the way that we do that is we make our model. Our model should be that y is a constant plus another constant times x plus another constant times x squared. And so we put all of our data together, and we say for each data point, we have a point x and a point y. What we're really looking at is 1x and x squared that we take combinations of. And so we have these n equations and three unknowns. And so we have this n by 3 matrix times these three entries equals this n vector. You know, as always, we solve A transpose A, C equals A transpose Y, and A transpose A just winds up being things that involve the sum of the x's, the sum of the x squareds, the sum of the x cubes, and actually the sum of the x to the fourths. And A transpose Y involves sum of the y's, sum of the x y's, and sum of the x squared y's. Again, you get a 3 by 3 system, solve it by row reduction. If we wanted to fit something as a cubic, well, then we'd have the matrix A would have a column of 1's, a column of x's, a column of x squareds, and a column of x cubes, and so on. Of course, the more terms you give yourself, the better a fit you're likely to get. Okay. Next, we're going to look at things that are not linear. Some things you know a priori should behave like exponentials. You know that y should go as a constant times an exponential in x. And that's just not a linear equation. It doesn't seem amenable to linear algebra. But if you take the log of both sides, you get the log of y is the log of c plus k times x. And you're trying to solve for c and k. So if you think of c and log c and k as your variables, now you do have a linear relation. And there it is. We want 1's and x's times log c and k to give you the log y's. So we're going to find log c and k that make this product on the left-hand side be as close as possible to this vector on the right-hand side. And then, of course, our answer isn't going, you know, we have to exponentiate the first component to get c back again, but that gives us back c and k. So if you look at A transpose A, it's just what it always was for a straight line fit. N, sum of x's, sum of the x squareds. A transpose this is kind of like what we're used to doing for linear regression, except we have log y's instead of y's. Now, another way to do this is graphically. This is a piece of semi-log paper, the graph paper. The distance horizontally is proportional to x, but the distance vertically is proportional to log of y. So if you have something that is given by an approximant exponential, then after you plot it on this semi-log paper, what you'll get is something that looks more or less like a straight line. Last thing is we're going to look at power laws. There are some models where, for theoretical reasons, you believe that y should grow like a power of x. But you don't know what the constant in front should be, and you don't know which power of x. So the unknowns are c and p. Again, that's not a linear system. But if you take the log of both sides, you do get a linear system. Remember, you're trying to solve for log c and for p. And once again, we can set up our equations. Log y equals log c plus p times the log of x. Okay. Once again, it's a 2x2 system. We can write down our A transpose A. And we can find the inverse of this matrix, multiply it by this vector, and we get this vector. Now, again, be careful. The answer you get is not c and p, it's log c and p. And then you exponentiate log c to get back c. This can also be expressed in terms of fancy graph paper. This is log-log paper. The horizontal distance is the log of x. The vertical distance is the log of y. So if the log of y is a constant plus p times the log of x, then this should show up as a straight line in the log paper, and the slope of that straight line is p, and the intercept is going to give you log c. And that's it for doing a whole bunch of other kinds of regression besides straight line fits using least squares.